Kohol maita hat yeribin bih by wata ho by ka oh make me clean, don't wash me down, without within, all purged by fire, he that must be, no matter how, if only thy house in me, thy house in me. The glare of thee shone now in power, grateful and glad my soul shall be, but yet at love a purer heart is more to me, is more to me. So wash me now, purged with fire, if that must be, no matter how, if only sin, thy house in me, thy house in me. Yes, holy heart, this heart is clean. My light of thee shone yet be mine. For mirrored in its depths are seen the things divine. Thus in divine, so wash me thou, without, within, all purged with fire, if that must be, no matter how, if only sin, thy house in me, thy house in me. So wash me thou, without, within, all purged with fire, if that must be, no matter how, if only sin, thy house in me, thy house in me. I watch to shine the miry way and stanch the spring of guilty thought, but watch and struggle as I lay. Pure I am not, pure I am not, so wash me thou, without, within, all purged with fire, if that must be, no matter how, if only things die out in me, die out in me, so wash me down, me down within, or purge with fire, if that must be. Lord, no matter how, if only sin die out in me, die out in me, so wash me now, without, within, or purge with fire, if that must be. No matter how, if only sin die out in me, Lord, die out in me.
I think you have a prayer to pray. A sin will die out in you. And so much as sin is alive, all the services, all the efforts that we do becomes unacceptable unto Him. Therefore, my prayer and your prayer is the prayer of the soloist. Cannot do it myself. I want to sound that merry way. I want to smell the spring of guilty thoughts. Yet watch as careful as I may, pure I am not, pure I am not. I hope at this time that God will make you pure. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they only shall see God. Walk before me and be perfect, that we, being delivered from the hands of our enemies, might serve without fear. Fear of death, fear of enemies, fear of falling, but in holiness and righteousness before Him every day of our life. Our Father, we thank you because it is possible that a man can be clean every minute of the hour, every hour of the day, every day of the week of the month, every month of the year. The price you have paid, that once and for all at Calvary. Lord, we pray that here at this time, we all be partakers of these once and for all provisions of purity, of cleanness, of holiness, of sanctification in Jesus' name. That our lives, only one life, shall be an offering unto you, something pleasant and acceptable unto you. Do it in every heart. Delay not and defer not. Cause us, Lord God, to approach your presence even this hour and be clean. Let the fire of your presence, that purified fire, make us clean within and without all the days of our life and from now onward in Jesus' name. Teach us your word now. We pray, Lord God, will not just be hearers, be partakers of divine holiness. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In the study we are going through now, we have in the Bible teaching, and the title is The Attributes of a Sanctified Life. The attributes of a sanctified life. You are aware that sanctification is not just a doctrine cooked up by a church, brought together by a denomination, desired by a personality, but is a requirement, a qualification required by God. You are aware that God as an individual is holy. God is a holy personality living in holy heaven, and he has given us his holy words to guide us unto holiness, that ultimately we might become holy and live holy with him throughout all eternity. But to start with, what is this holiness? When you talk about sanctification, when you talk about holiness, there is often some mistakes that people make. You know, a number of people who disbelieve holiness or sanctification today, they believe, they need to disbelieve because they have not been properly taught. Maybe we have confused them. Maybe we are the one that made them disbelieve it. Perhaps it is that they have not been properly taught what holiness is. Simply put, what is holiness? In the book of Titus, chapter 2, Titus 2, and in verse 14, Titus chapter 2, I'm reading with you quickly in verse 14. What is holiness? Titus 2, verse 14. Who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. If you understand better, let me start reading from verse 12 of the same chapter, Titus chapter 2, from verse 11, rather, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation had appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and denying worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearance of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity. If you like, in your Bible, underline all iniquity. And purified himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. All we call sanctification is summarized in that verse of scripture. Christ gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity. You say, isn't that salvation? No, not salvation. As salvation, you are redeemed from iniquity, but not redeemed from all iniquity. Oh, isn't that a heresy? Aren't we free from sin as salvation? Yes, you are free from sin, or you are free from outward sin, outward iniquity, lying no more, seeking examination no more, fornication no more, masturbation no more, fighting and quarreling no more, keeping malice no more. As salvation, that is done away with. Sin we can visibly see. See, we can identify from the outside. See, your bedmates or your roommate can see. The sin that the pastor can point out, the sin that the brethren can correct, is no more in you as salvation. That is taken away. You are redeemed from iniquity, but outward iniquity. But the one that cannot see and is not visible unto us, for us, you are still proud in the heart. Humble in the outward, you bow down, you greet everybody. We even rebuke you, you bow down your head. And you don't even say anything. You don't defend yourself in the outward. You say, he's a humble brother, he's a humble sister. You are bending in the outward, but your heart is not bending in the inward. You are not fighting, you are not retaliating, but there's a boiling within. So that even though you are redeemed from the iniquity that is outward, there is no redemption from the iniquity that is inward. That individual is not yet sanctified all the same. You are only struggling not to fight. Your hand that you are pocketing is almost stealing your pocket and slap the person. But at least Calvary is presenting that. But within you, it's like, I hope I'm ready. I would have dealt with him. Within you, there is this kind of boiling, this kind of push, this kind of urge to commit sin, even though you are not doing it in the outward. But when holiness express comes, when the final comes, that's a redemption. from both outward and the inward iniquity and the snare and the spring of guilty thoughts. You don't want to lust. You don't have a boyfriend, you don't have a girlfriend. You don't watch pornography sites. You don't read that. You don't read dirty books. If you see something that's in your place, you remove your guilt. That's salvation. That's wonderful. But then, some dirty imagination is going on within you. Some appetite is going on within you that you don't appreciate. And this time, you keep saying, I bind you, Satan. I bind you, Satan, repeatedly. That is continual with you. That is like the song of the soloist. He said, I wash to snatch the spring of guilty thoughts. And I want to smith to snatch the spring of guilty thoughts. He said, but pure I am not. Pure I am not. I struggled. Your life here, that was struggling. Struggling within. But when salvation comes, thank God, that holy quietness, holy stillness, inward quietness, inward stillness will come. Struggling no more. Now, you will not be tempted any longer. Yes, you are tempted. Because everybody that is living on earth will still be tempted. That was tempted. Though holy and sanctified. Though holy and harmless. Though undefined. It was still tempted. But then, the urge, the push, the longing, the appetite for sin is dealt away with right there at sanctification. That is what it means by redemption from inward iniquity, but outward flesh. Then inward followed. What do you mean by sanctification? In Psalm 19, in verse 12. Psalm 19, verse 12. Read with me there in verse 14, Psalm 19. I'm reading with you quickly in verse 12. Verse 12, as well through to verse 14. Are we there, please? Psalm 19, verse 12, verse 13, and verse 14. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse thou me from secret faults. The secret, we don't see it. We are praising you, but inward. In the inside of your conscience, and not pushing yourself. That secret fault within you, that ego within you. If something happens and we don't take your opinion, that tends to withdraw within you. If you are rebuked, even when you are wrong, that all to defend yourself. You want to come, you want to cover your own fault. And that is your own tendency. He says, who can understand his errors? Even right now, you are even confused. You don't even know when you are wrong or when you are right. You are moving up within. That's lack of sanctification. You don't understand your error any longer. It says, cleanse thou me from secret faults. This afternoon, God will cleanse you from the secret faults. From the outward, you know, many times, we are quick to confess things that are outward because others see it. We don't like it. We don't appreciate it. Not as well. Feel guilty in this area. Maybe something happened and the way you behave and they correct you. They're not happy. That's normal. That's not correct. And many a times, we want to work hard on those external faults more than the inward fault. The inward fault, nobody sees it. And therefore, there is an external to work on it. But it's now saying, cleanse thou me from secret faults. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression. Sanctification means innocence. Virginity of the spirit. That's sanctification. That you are innocent. You are not guilty in any form. That within you, your motive is right. Even though your method may be wrong, but you have a good intention. Even though you don't, the way you carry it out, you may lack knowledge. You might be wrong. But in the inward, you have holy intention, good desire, godly desire, godly intention in carrying out what you are doing. You are not doing it just for personal aggrandizement. You are not doing it for personal pleasure. You are not doing it for praise. You are not doing it for just for ego. You are just doing it for holy motives. That is a sanctified person. Verse 14, let the words of my mouth, when you are sanctified, it can affect your tongue. The sanctification that makes your tongue untamable is not the sanctification of the Bible. It says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, my tongue, my thoughts. Your thoughts and your tongue, they are in consonance. And you know, he said, out of the abundance of the heart, what happened? The mouth speaketh. And so, if your thought is right, your tongue also will be right. But by the time your tongue is a basket, you are not holy, you are not sanctified. You want to enjoy some holy quietness. And he said, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart. Can you say that also? Is it possible? Are you sure that the meditation of your heart is right? As if it's possible. You know, they talk about CT scan, talk about X-ray, talk about scanning now. If it's possible to have a spiritual scanning and we scan your thoughts, or even this morning now, to today, even though we are in this fellowship, we are in this meeting, we are right in God's presence even right now. If it's possible to scan my thoughts, scan your thoughts, and displays it on a PowerPoint or on a projector, and as everybody sees thought, will you still be happy? Will you not feel ashamed? So David didn't want that. Now he says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. My thoughts are so that men are they run riots. And it's like you. A water is issuing forth, a running water, maybe a river, and they say it's bitter, like Elijah was told. Elijah did not just get that to a portion of that water and pour salt there. If that was happening, he would have only healed a portion of that water, and the water, the portion he healed, would have get mixed up with the portion he did not heal. Am I right? But what did he do? He went to the source of the water. He poured water there. He poured soil and stuff there. And when that happened, the water ceased being bitter. I pray God will touch your source. If God touches your heart, that is the inner source of the personality. That is the origin, the spring of the whole you. If God will stop touching your spirit, your thoughts, and go to your innermost being and pour his salt there and make you wise from the heart, then everything out of you becomes wise. And so when we talk about sanctification, it means redemption from all iniquity. Again, what is sanctification? Sanctification means perfection. That you know very well. Genesis chapter 17. Genesis 17. Read with me there. In verse 1. Genesis 17. Read with me quickly in verse 1. Genesis 17. In verse 1. And when Abraham was 90 years old, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. Walk before me, comma, salvation. When you are walking before God, you are saved. But that is the word that is perfect. Because all this was what we want, yes, it's true. You've left all of Kazis. You've acted to my call. You've answered my call. That's a type of salvation. You've left your kindred. You've left your nation. You've left your city. You've left your town. You've left your people. You've left certainty for certainty. You believe me. You've embarked on a journey of faith. I said, come out of your people. You pack your things. You took your wife. You took Camilla and Sarah. And you went away. And you took Lot. You know, I didn't appreciate that you took loss. At least you left your people and you left your environment and you hearken to my call. That's the kind of salvation. But that will not be enough. That one is walking before me. That's all right. But many a time, you see some things that you want shady. You get to a place, you consider your means, your junior sister. And if you even though it's foolish, it's your sister, it's your relative, but now it's your wife. In the context of discussion, you are insincere. There are some insincerity with you. Abraham, I see you being impatient as well. Try to help yourself. And it's like Sarah was taking you out of my will and was arranging things for you. Therefore, Abraham, walk before me. Come on. Walk before me now and be perfect. That is sanctification. But when you begin to walk before God and you are faultless and you are unblameable in holiness, then you are sanctified. That is what means by sanctification. Hebrews 10, in verse 14. See where it leans? perfection now with sanctification. Hebrews 10. Look with me there quickly in verse 14. Hebrews 10 and in verse 14. For by one offering, he has perfected. See the word there again? Perfect. Many people don't want to hear that word. You see that you are parading yourself as holier than thou. You are saying you are perfect. You are not claiming to be perfect in the knowledge, in head. No. You may say something like things that are wrong. As a pastor, I can rebuke you wrongly. And I may not know. But sanctification should now make me, when I declare that I'm wrong, to call you and say, my brother, no, I am sorry. That is sanctification now. That's perfection. And I'll be wrong with what I did to you. And I'm coming to you to ask me, I'm coming to you. Maybe you came late. And I've forgotten I was going to send you on an errand that made you come late. And I say, stop there. Since all your years in the short, this time you should be coming to ask me things. I'm an hour. Now the thing is, you say you are writing an exam. You have finished your exam some days ago. I knew about you. See the time you are just coming. And you are a coordinator. And I threw that way. I had no chance, no opportunity to say, pastor, you sent me. And I kept quiet. And Jeff set him there. And I said, go and say at the back. And he said, true. And after he said, pastor, I'm the other time you are talking to me. So why you said I should go? That I went. And that was why I was just coming to me from the place. As I said, I didn't know, I forgot it. I'm very, very sorry. Please forgive me. That is sanctified man. But the one you come around and say, yes, even when we look wrongly, if you take it, you are not sanctified. No matter how you preach. Sanctification does not have perfection in the head. He's talking about perfection in the heart. Read it once again. Hebrews 10 and in verse 14. For by one offering, he has perfected forever them that are sanctified. It's an expression of once and for all. That once you have, he keeps on. You are perfected forever. Them that are sanctified, they are perfected. Sanctification number one means redemption from all iniquity. Sanctification number two means perfection. Number three, sanctification means a clean heart. Clean heart, clean heart. In Psalm 51. Actually, the song that the Holy sang for us just recently now, if you look at the title of that song in Bodman Hina, that is a clean heart. And a clean heart is what is possible. Once the heart is clean, actions will be clean. Reactions will be clean. God will not only judge you on the basis of your action, he will also be judged on the basis of your reaction. Just like my student. What have you done to him? Yes, he's the one that first blew me. He blew me. He shook me. He judged me why, the reason why he has beaten his younger brother. Or the other brother. Another one is crying. What have you done to him? He's either of saying I beat me. Just like he was the one that fell off or beat me. After that, he was justifying his reaction. God is not looking at whether you are right or wrong. If your reaction is not godly, it's not vital, it's not scriptural, then you are out of it. It again. The book of Psalm 51. Psalm 51. And in verse 10. Psalm 51. Be with me. Quickly. In verse 10. Psalm 51. And in verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit. Where? Within me. A clean heart, a right spirit. That spirit that rejoices when others are rejoicing. Are you aware that it is possible? Let this suicide happen. Something good happens to another person in the church. You won't hinder him from enjoying what is good. You are not a witch, you are not a wizard. You won't go to Harvardis, the Jason. You won't go into enchantment or division against him. Won't physically block him from experiencing or enjoying what is good, but something good happened to him. It's yet to happen to you. You are greeting him, you are connecting with him, but in the inward of you, in the inside of you, you are not happy. Are you aware it's happening? I wish you said this happened. Oh, sister, I said, God tell you, this lady happening, and you will not know. My prayer conscience will be next Saturday. Some people will be following me, but I shouldn't have gone that far. Haven't gone that far. Then you are my friend. I think you should know. From that moment forward, start picking fault. And whatever the sad did, what is the problem? Problem was envy. There is no right spirit. right, righteous. And the spirit in the inside of you is against good things. It's not that you are potent. And that you are not even happy with yourself, and it's happening that way. And you are saying, God, what is happening to me that way? It's luck, it's disfortunate. Now I'm not happy. I bind that spirit. God, help me. Help. There are times and that person says something good. He says, it's interesting in me, her result. She has an A. You had a B or C. And within you, envy has spirit against the rising up. You like the right spirit. That is the prayer of David. Maybe pray that prayer. And you should pray it as well. Create in me a clean heart. Oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. The spirit of Christ. Renew it within me. Christ says, be rejoicing with those that are rejoicing. More than them that mourn. Something bad has happened to her or to him. His cause has broken. And now he's shattered. Because I have never convinced. And now the brother is now unhappy. He's even crying, sleeping. You are going there to console him. But in the inside of you, you are rejoicing. You are not laughing. You are also making your face for you somehow. I think you are not happy too. You get there, you say, you are even cooking for me, you are giving him food. He said, let's go and eat. That is not sending there. Look, don't worry. And now one will come. That's good. That's good of you. Take him to New Booker. You can buy food for him. You pay it. And say, let's go. I don't want him to be alone. Take him to New Booker. And you are just there with me with him. But instead of you are living a life of duplicity. You are playing a sympathetic role. But in the inside of you, there is a kind of feeling of rejoicing that you are this happy. That happens to him. You are not confused. You are mixed up. You need sanctification. So he says, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. Again, what is sanctification? Sanctification means a more excellent way. The way of law. The book of 1 Corinthians 12. 1 Corinthians 12. In verse 31. 1 Corinthians 12. In verse 31, 1 Corinthians 12. Read me quickly. In verse 31. But convert earnestly the best gifts. And yet, show I unto you a more excellent way. It is good to prophesy. It is good to be a preacher. It is good to be an evangelist. It is good to be a pastor. It is good to give words of knowledge. You need to work miracles. But then, there is a better gift than this. A more excellent gift. The gift of love. The experience of love. When you really experience Christ-like love in your heart, you are sanctified. So if you love, you will love God. He said, which is the greater commandment? He said, fear O Israel. The Lord God is one God. Thou shalt love thy God with all thy heart. When you can love God with all your heart, you are sanctified. No compartment, no corner, no department of your heart that God has own. And it's not devoted wholly unto God. You love God with all your belongings, with all your property, with all your mind, with all your strength. And also the second is like unto it. That's another thy limit, thy neighbor, thy friend, as thyself. When that happens also, you are sanctified. You can effectively say, what I want for myself is what I want for anybody, any brother, any sister. And no envy, no jealousy, no hatred. Yes, when you committed, when you do what is wrong, you forgive yourself. Am I right? About yourself. You excuse what is wrong about yourself. That you are able to forgive others perfectly. Not thinking about it any longer. Not looking for a way of revenge. You are not disposed negatively. And say, the other time this is also what he did to me. When you can behave that way, act that way, react that way, imagine that way, meditate that way, think that way, then we say you are sanctified. And you love God with all your heart. God can say, bring anything, you can bring it. God can say, do it with this one, you can do it with this. All that you know, just let me just know the mind of God. Then I am true. Then you are sanctified. That's talking about sanctification. All this theology that we go into, that's not even really important. All we need to know is what that experience actually means. That is sanctification. And we have promises in Scripture in Psalm 68. Psalm 68, verse 13. Psalm 68, be with me there, in verse 13. Psalm 68, I'm reading with you, in verse 13. Though you have lined among the pots, what's the color of pots? Answer me now. I have a loud black. and you have learned among the poor, what will you now become? Become blind. So you have learned among the poor. Yet shall you be as wing of a dove. I will cleanse you, covered with silver. I will not only cleanse you, I will insulate you from sin. I will cover it with silver. And her feathers with what? Yellow gold, purity. Both inside purity. I will not only cleanse you, you'll be like those. You've been black and dark before, you'll not be like those. That's salvation. Then I will now cover it with silver. I will cover the feather with gold. You know that when you are sanctified, you are going around, there is sin all around, there is impurity all around, there is bitterness all around, but like there's something insulating your heart. It's like you are seeing them, but it's not touching you. Your heart is like there is a door between your heart and what you are saying. That's sanctification, that's purity. That's what God is saying. I want to do here, and I want to pray here this day. If you take nothing in this program, if all I have been preaching on the beginning of the semester, just nothing to you. If all I have been hearing Bible study, it does not matter to you. If all I have been hearing what happened, it does not change you. Let something happen this hour and this moment, that this experience we are talking about, you will have it. I said you will have it. I'm praying you will have it. Three shepherds. Number one, the picture of sanctification. Picture. Let's put sanctification in picture. I got what you call teaching aids. Let's illustrate sanctification. Number two, the progress of the sanctifier. The attributes that must be demonstrated, exemplified. As you say, an individual is really of a truth sanctified. Number three, the process of sanctification. How do we get it? How do we achieve it? How do we obtain it? How do we receive it? That's what we're talking about now. As doctrine. Point number one now, the pictures of sanctification. You know this thing I've told you before, but I'm telling you again, John chapter 2. And number 13, John chapter 2. Be with me quickly in verse 13. John chapter 2. I'm meeting with you in verse 13. John 2, 13. And the Jews' Passover was at hand. And Jesus went up to Jerusalem and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and those and the changers of money sitting. And when he had made a scourge of small cords, he drove them all out of the temple and the sheep and the oxen and brought out the changers' money and overthrew the tables. You know what happened here? People often come to Jerusalem, walk from different part of the world. Ethiopia, you know, came to Jerusalem around this time for this feast. And what happened is that when they come like that, there are some sacrifices that will normally be done. And you have to buy some food there in the town, in the city. Buy maybe those, depending on the sacrifices. You want to do some offering, some cleansing. But instead of you want to make, that's what you call nearness to market, a market oriented industry, you want to make it close to people that will use it. And so, people now brought all those things that they will need near to the temple. They brought them to the temple. That we still make our profit, make our gain, make our money here. Doves will be there, lambs will be there, goats will be there, everything will be there. But what do you need? You possess it here, then you use it here. Instead of going to the city, it's not like you are doing a retreat. And people are coming from town, they're not in the church, they're not part of the city, you want to come and sell things. And they just come, come and make gains. And sometimes the one you don't bring, they will tell you that one is not, it is bad. See, it's already tired. The body is all the way from Ethiopia. And it's already, see, sun has smoothing on it, and the way it's working. Our priest will not take, God will not take this kind of offering from you. There are fresh ones here. And that's the kind of argument they were making. Then you come up with your currency. And the currency you are bringing, there's a bureau of shame, like in the temple. Why you can change the currency or the coin that was spent there? And the purpose of worship, the reason for the temple, the procedure in the temple, had not been altered, had not been affected. And they are now being infected and being defiled, being distorted. And the worship is now being disturbed. And Jesus came. This is not the purpose of the temple. This is not why it was established. This is not what God really wants. And he got there, he made a scourge.
And he drew them out,
the sellers and the commodities. And they all left the place. Can you imagine what would be happening at the temple? Number one, like the noise in the temple. Am I right?
That's what happens to you when you are not sanctified. You are that temple. When I am sanctified, there are the different noises. Many of you are saying, I'm praying. I don't know the will of God. There are different noises in your heart. You are not sanctified. You won't hear God. Because noise is coming from the flesh. Noise is coming from your mind. Noise is coming from your head. And when there's noise all around like that, you can't hear the voice of God. And there should have been noise in the temple. And it's meant to be a place of solemnity. And because of those noises, the world will be affected. And so he said, take this thing hence. This is my father's house. And he drove them out. And because not only noise, when there's noise in the temple, there's a distraction. Am I right? This is why men of people are going to focus in the place of prayer. It's because they're not sanctified. You are there, you are kneeling down, you are praying, 35 minutes, you are still struggling. Some things are competing with your thoughts. You can't log on directly to the throne of grace. You are not, you can't hook up easily onto heaven. You are struggling within you. There's distraction all around. Even when you are going, different thought is coming to your heart. That is holding different thoughts, imagination, getting ones into your heart. Terrible ones. The one that you are ashamed, let people know that you are thinking about, they are coming to your house, distractions. There was distraction in the temple because the people are selling and buying there. And you know, when they sell and buy, they take out of you, they bring something, they take something in. If you are selling something, what do you do? You give out your commodity, collect money. Am I right? The same way, when you are not sanctified, every express of life will be taking grace out of you. I'll be bringing back something that will sell you. The way you go out will not be the way you will come in. You will be affected. Your level will shake. You will come down. You came out of you had a very good quiet time that day. And you came out of the house at the mountaintop. But then you are coming back right now. You are already down. When you see this lady, that lady. When that person said something that you didn't really appreciate. And you are almost telling him. And you are carrying the wound and the grudge. And this one is coming to forgive me to apologize. You can't even forgive. That distraction within you. That's noise. That distraction. That is what happens when an individual is not sanctified. Again, that confusion. There have been noises all around in the temple. People are talking. That's what I was talking. Even what you want to hear, you won't really hear again. You when you are confused, many times. You know God's will, you know God's purpose, you know God's plan. This is why you don't understand this truth so many times. It's because there are noises within you. There are things that are selling and buying within you. But thank God today, Christ will drag them out. Some of you are sleeping already. I said God will drag them out. You see a bigger amen, those who are sleeping, they will wake up. I said God will drag them out. And so he made his calls. And he drew them out. It once again. Now, in verse 14 and 15, Matthew, John, verse 2. Now, in verse 14. John chapter 2, now in verse 14, and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and those and the singers of money sitting. And when he had made a score of small cords, he drove them all out of the temple, not remaining, all out. Don't say, I'm free from lust, I'm free from malice, I'm free from bitterness. The thing that remains now. He got that envy and not sanctified. He drove them all out. One that is something remaining, it's not yet holy. One that is a stain in your garment, is it clean? I'm asking you, is that garment clean? Not at all. So he drove them all out. And eventually, in verse 15, and when he had made his cord or small, he drove them all out. Now, verse 15, and said to them, that sold those. Say these things, hence, make not my father's house and house of merchandise. The purpose is defeated. It will be a place of prayer. It's now becoming a place of merchandise. When you are not sanctified, you are not really what you ought to be. You can't be what you ought to be for God. And so, take them out here. Don't make it a house of merchandise. That is what. So, when we talk about the picture of celebration, it's really the picture of the temple being poured. And I pray this morning or this afternoon, go and purge your temple.
I say, God will purge your temple. If you are sleeping, I will tell a lot of people right up and now be listening to me while standing. It is possible. So if you make me that one, I will do, as I'm looking around, if I see you sleeping, I will tell everybody now to stand up and be hearing and the writing and the jotting and I'm talking while standing. You want to do that? I'm asking you. So then, don't sleep. I've asked your GC whether you can take what I want to say without having a break. Then you can take. That's why I'm cutting. Otherwise, I will give you a break before now. But now that you are here, and I'm here, no sleeping anyhow. Are you hearing me now? I'm going to sleep later. But now, no sleeping. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. So then, it's not only noise, it's only distraction. You know that it's distraction. Who will fight? If we argue, normal is normal in the market. And all the conflict going on within you, when you are not sanctified, and the conflict within you, it's like you are 80% interested in something, 20% withdrawn. You are not sure where you belong. That is, when someone lacks sanctification, there is the conflict within the spirit man. He's not really disposed. He's not sure what to do. That is, what happens when there is no sanctification, but when the temple is purged, and they are all taken away, the temple becomes what it ought to become. Again, Deuteronomy 21, and in verse 18, Deuteronomy 21, read with me, in verse 18, Deuteronomy 21, in verse 18, quickly, if a man has a stubborn and rebellious son, which will not obey the voice of his father or the voice of his mother, and that when they have chastened him, will not hearken unto them, then shall his father and his mother lay hold on him and bring him out unto the elders of the city and unto the gate of his place, and they shall say unto the elders of his city, this our son is stubborn and rebellious, he will not obey our voice. He is a glutton and a drunkard, and all the men of the city shall throw him with stones that he die. So shall thou put evil away from among you, and all Israel shall hear and fear. Your old man will die. I see your old man will die. That, like that song says, he said, only if sin will die out in me, sin in you will die out. That's what he's talking about here. You have a rebellious son. As a father, as a mother. As a brother, you are a father. As a sister, you are a mother. In the context of this passage now, you have a rebellious son. That rebellious son is your heart. And he won't hear words. What you don't want in the heart is what is coming in. What you want the heart to bring out, that's what will be easing out. You have struggled, the heart will not obey. He said, what you now do is that, don't pamper, don't excuse that child. Don't excuse that son. This is why we're not talking about that. We are excusing our faults. If you know what I'm doing is wrong, this is what they call lack of sanctification. Faith is. But if I say, well, that's my own weakness, if we die with you go to hell as a result of it. Said, learn to do well. But if you don't learn it, and you don't come to the altar, and what is here is not right, and lay it on the altar, the parents will be the one to show forth, bring forth, to present their son, the rebellious son. It's not the elder of the city that will come and say, where is that son? No. The release, the surrendering, it's in your own hand. That's how we say about consecration before sanctification. You are the one to issue it out. And so, they bring their son. And so the elders of the city, see it again now, in that passage of scripture, then his father and his mother lay hold on him and bring him out unto the elders of the city, unto the gate of his place. And they shall say unto the elders of the city, this our son is stubborn and rebellious. That's why, as sanctification, you talk. Sanctification does not come to a silent person. That's supplication, not sanctification. You don't keep quiet and feel that, well, since I've been in a holy environment, I'll be holy all the same. No. No, sir. No, ma'am. There are some transactions that will go between you and God in talking. So, they will bring their son, and they will say, this is our son. As I'm looking at him, he may look gentle, but he's a terrible person. He's rebellious. He's evil. He's prodigal. He won't hear correction. He's in progress of correction, and he's a violent person. And they will hand him over.
as they hand it over, they enter and they die at the gate. That's why, as they hand it over, then he be stoned that he died. Isn't that cruel? Until you start to be cruel with yourself, because your greatest enemy is yourself. Then you can't make heaven. So you bring that your heart out and say it's rebellious. You tell God, God is unclean. Is this is dirty? Is defiling? Is the source of my defilement? I bring it unto you. You are a body, you are a father, you are a mother. And as you bring to the elders of the city. Who are the elders? God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. That they are working at the city. Christ also, and my sanctified disciples, suffered without the gate. This is elders means you are not at the gate here. And you bring that your heart there, and it will be stored and crushed. And then if you die, then a new heart, a new claim, a clean heart will be given in thee unto you. And we start all together. You take away the heart of stone out of your heart. Is it possible? I'm asking, is it possible? It is possible. We will do it for you. I say we do it for you. No, it's like purging the temple. It's like surrendering the devil, giving a rebellious song. Picture of sanctification now. And may I tell you as well, still when the temple is purged, if you are careless in sanctification, you have to look for it again. Many of you said that. If I say, feed the form. When were you sanctified? Many people say, 1989, maybe. So people will sanctify 1995. Where is it now? The love of women are flying away. So Christ, when he bought the temple the first time, you know, that was not all. He came back again and recalled, because by the time he left the place, if you leave your sanctification and don't fan it, like you fan the coal of fire and keep the fire on, something will come, it will be taken away. You know, Christ has to come again and how to repair the same temple. Let me show you the book of Matthew 21 and in verse 12. Matthew 21. Do it with me in verse 12. Verse 12 to 13. Matthew 21 to Matthew 12. Verse 12 to verse 13. And just went into the temple of God. This is second purification. And cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple. You are already used to it. You enjoy that kind of way, send them away. And overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold those. What was overthrown can still be indexed. Am I right? And said unto them, it is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer. We have made it a den of thieves. House of prayer. That when you are sanctified, there's an altar of prayer in you. Your heart is even making a continual prayer unto God. That's the express of those who are sanctified. So, number one, it's like forgetting the temple. Number two, it's like sending to ending the rebellious song. Number three now, it's in Isaiah 6, verse 5. Isaiah 6. It's Midian, verse 5. Isaiah 6. I'm reading with you, quickly, in verse 5. Verse 5 to verse 7. Isaiah 6. That transforming vision. The other King Isaiah died. Something happened. Isaiah 6. Reading with you. Quickly. Now in verse 5. Are we there? Are we there? Then said I, woe is me. I've been saying woe unto others. Ladies and gentlemen, sanctification is not just, well, don't be proud before God. It doesn't matter your level of office in the church. If you are not sanctified today, tell God I'm not sanctified. If you have lost it before, tell God, give me. If I lost it and you are now, tell God I want to regain it. If you say, woe to you, woe to you, woe to you. Today now, he's saying, woe is me. Until you say something and you declare your inadequacies and your helpless, utter helplessness before God, there can't be progress. And now he said, woe then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips. Salvation will take place. You must say something. That's why you want to keep quiet when I finish to pray. And I pray a passionate prayer. And I dwell in the midst of the people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which are taken with the tongues from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, these are toys that live, and that they took his duty, he's taking away salvation, and that sin is what?
Pulse, sanctification. Here your sin will be pulse. I see your sin will be pulse. So people are saying amen. I see your sin will be pulse.
That's sanctification. It's possible. We have a sanctified source. We have a progressive source. If God is holy, there is no limit to which God is ready to take that church. All the things we are expressing is because there's no holiness in the church. There's holiness in the pulpit, holiness in the pew, and we're all holy together. We are going places, and we get to places. And then we get there. Again, what is sanctification? In Genesis chapter 17, I showed you before, but let me now show you this one. Genesis 17, in verse 10, Genesis 17. You with me there? In verse 10, the petition of sanctification. Genesis 17. Do with me there, quickly. In verse 10, this is my covenant, which is a key between me and you. And I see after this, every man's child among you shall be circumcised. Circumcision of the heart. If you have a young lad and not sanctified, that first thing that will be removed. Initially, it will be a seed. It's the same consequential. But later, it will be the source of all infections in the body. That is why it's just part of what people call hygiene. I will remove the first thing. And also spiritually, to the spiritual hygienist, you remove the first thing of your heart. Because that is the source, that is the connection between your heart and the world, between your heart and sin. And when that is taken away, then you are holy and you are righteous. I pray here this afternoon, God will take you there. Point number two now, the portrait of the sanctified. The portrait of the sanctified. 2 Samuel 12. 2 Samuel 12. Verse 26. 2 Samuel 12. Read with me quickly. In verse 26. 2 Samuel 12. Reading with you. In verse 26. And Joab falls against Reba of the children of Ammon and took the royal city. And Joab sent messengers to David and said, I fought against Reba and I've taken the city of waters. Now therefore gather the rest of the people together and then come against the city and take it, lest I take the city, and it be called after my name. How see that city of Joab here? He has fought a battle. He has won many cities. And he called for the king. Come quickly. Take it over. It is true, I fought and I got it. But don't forget, I'm your officer. You made me minister for defense. That's why I'm fighting the battle. Now it's for you. I'm fighting for you. Come and take the city over. It's not meant for me. So I can now begin to parade myself even there. That's what men of God, that's what men of us lack. When you are sanctified and you are really truly currently sanctified, you do everything to the glory of God. You don't want to be shamed. You don't want to parade yourself. When you are in the pulpit, you are not there to showcase your talent or your ability. You are not there for show. You are not there for pride. Anything you are doing this show, or after the show, you want God alone to be glorified. Drop David and fall, but come, lest I name it against myself. You want to make a name for yourself. And those that are building Babel of three, Babel Tower, let's come here. Let us not be dispatched, that we may make a name for ourselves. That's not your purpose. So drop was doing better. And that's a display of sanctification in our own dispensation. When you are sanctified, what happened? Number one, that is serenity. Serenity in your heart, holy quietness, holy stillness, serenity. Within you are pure, you are serene. It's that quietness within you, no noise. And as I told you before, that happened in the temple, and what that is serenity in Psalm 3, verse 2. Psalm 3, read with me quickly. In verse 2, Psalm 3, I'm reading with you. There in verse 2, Psalm 23, and in verse 2, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside what? The sea water. that the stillness, that the still water within you. Your water, the water within you had been boiling before. You know, when water is boiling, if it boils, it will almost be, if it be leaving the pot, am I right? That is, and that is the one that leaves the pot, is the one we see outside. But now, when there is sanctification, there is stillness. Your water is not boiling any longer. There is quietness everywhere, quietness within. That deep sobriety, deep stillness. That is one of the attributes, one of the things we see in us. And we say, we are sanctified. We are, you know, that's why we are not even talking anyhow. Reason because you don't want to do the stillness. You enjoy the stillness, the quietness. The glorious experience is that of sanctification. That you will enjoy it. Listen, you are not sanctified for the source. You are sanctified for that enjoyment of sanctification. That you enjoy it. There is peace of sanctification. That pleasure of sanctification. It says, it's a drink of the river of thy pleasure. That's what it says. And when you are sanctified, that stillness, that serenity within you, it leaves you beside sea water. Number two, there's separation. Can be sanctified and you are mingling with the world. You are separated. For such a high priest beholds us, who is holy, harmless, undefined, separated from sinners, that's Christ. And so when you are sanctified also, the style of the world, the slang of the world, the garment of the world, the oppression of the world, the disposition of the world will not be yours any longer. You won't be doing things to conform with the world. Yes, you want to have confidence, you want to dress well and have confidence in your dress. I'm not saying you should be now be a proper, I mean, be dressing like a drag of sight. No. Now you'll be dressing like a tout. No. But then, you are not doing things just to conform. No. You are separated. In your ceremony, you are separated. In your actions, you are separated. You are a different person. When you are separate, when you are sanctified, you are already called out. Once you see an individual behaving like the world, and rather they correcting you, correcting your condition and your appearances, then there is a problem with you. We see you all together. There is strength, that's number one. Number two, there is separation. Number three, now, there is simplicity. That individual is sanctified. It's peacefully existing. It's approachable. It's not ferocious like lion. It's not like this. It's not that it's hard. It's not a sadist. You are simple. It's easy to talk to you. It's easy to approach you. It's easy to relate with you. You are not a complex person. So you'll be staying in your hall and you have your corner. And all that, they can't move near. It's, please, I don't want to have trouble. It's as long as those corner. And you have a trouble. As a sister. Yes? You lay your bed and the rug is there and everything. No, even house fly, they come there, you'll be in trouble. That's not sanctification. If you are sanctified, you are easy to deal with. Even when people are offending you, you find it easy to be offended. You are a simple person. That is just language. When you are becoming complex, in the name of whatsoever, that's not sanctification. When someone is complex, I say it's a believer. Yes, we are hard on sin. That's the truth. Christ also was hard on sin. Otherwise, you wouldn't send the people away. He drove the deer away. You say, well, you'll be laughing when he was driving them away. Am I right? He was so hard on you. But he still to relate with Christ. If Christ was coming, you are the one that will be coming, and he's going to be running for cover. Like many of us who are just there, I mean, are behaving. If that's the last time of Christ, John the Lord will not be leaning at his breast. And Peter will say, I thought will say, ask him, who is the person we're talking about? They find it a relationship with him. He wasn't different from them. In fact, that was why they needed Judas to betray him. It was to be wearing a regalia that was very big and be different from them. There's no problem. Every time you get there, his own dressing will be different. You see one man is wearing his own garment very big, and that someone will stand by the right, that one by the left. Anywhere he's sitting, the Zabu they will sit on the floor, he'll be sitting on the chair, and when he's sitting, that's one picking. But in his own case, it wasn't like that. He was just dressing like them. His great hand coming like them. He just everything like them. He was simple and was like them. That was why, if you don't look for someone to help us identify him, he may take Philip and think, I think it is Christ. You have taken. And the guy will release him. But time that is, and when you are beating him, I said, I'm not Christ. So I'm not the one. And this is my father's name. I said that happened. Then he will have made a mistake. They needed someone that could help him identify because he was simple. I feel it is simple. I'm not talking about being liberal with sin. No. I'm not talking about being liberal with what the world will stand. No, that's what I'm talking about. As a person, lifestyle, that you have the heart of the Lamb. You have the faith of the Lamb. And that you are simple. You are coming, people are happy that you are coming. By the time a person is running for his pastor, it's either that person has problems, or he himself has problems, or they don't have problems. When a person is coming, and his members, and they are running away, it's either his member has committed sin. Because when Adam and Eve committed sin, and God came to the queen, came down to the garden, said, I heard your voice and I was afraid. Maybe you have committed sin. All you are doing what is wrong, or you have done what is wrong, and his presence is convicting you. That may be the case. Or you are righteous. He's a troublemaker. He finds trouble where trouble doesn't exist. And he says to the pastor, if that is who are just here, if people are running away from you, and you are coming and they are avoiding you, or you are a brother or your sister, nobody wants to live with you in the room. You are not sweet. You are not simple. You are not sanctified. In fact, that is your salvation. Because if it is difficult to relate with you, then whom do we find it to relate with? So number one, there's serenity. Number two, there's simplicity. There's separation. Number three, there's serenity. Serenity of the spirit. Separation from the world. Simplicity in relationship. And number four, there's sincerity. Psalm 51 in verse 6. Sincerity. Psalm 51. Do it me there. In verse 6. Psalm 51. In verse 6. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward part, and in the hidden part, thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Thou shalt make me to know wisdom. If you also come around, and even this Psalm 1, the same thing is said there about who eventually get to heaven. Eventually, means you will see what was mean. Some of the things that were written later in some chapter of Psalm, talking about something. Sincerity. Within you in your heart, you are not saying something else and you mean something else. That is of diplomacy in the church. And you have to be careful the way you ask people questions. Yes, yes. Intellectual lie. And that you will talk this way and you will say some things. It's 50% yes, 50% no. 50% true, 50% lie. You can't really lay hand on him. But you now hold inside, but I said this one. And it's like people are now this kind of careful leadership. You see, you are your leader. It's not certification. But you will be sincere, transparently true, righteous. We can see from outside. Through you, we can see. You are not clean. That is what it means by sanctification. That's the attribute, the virtue of sanctification. And I say you will have it. I say you will have it. All this let's pretend exterior. Is there. God will take it away in Jesus' name. Again, number five, there's submission. Submission. If you are sanctified, your leader will have difficulty leading you. Shepherds lead sheep. When shepherds lead goats, the shepherd is in trouble. That's why he means shepherds. When he said he will take away the stony heart from you, then he will give you the heart of flesh. That of you make you submit to leadership. Wife will submit to husbands. Members will submit to leaders. In fact, friends and brethren, they will submit one to another. And in honor, to be preparing one another. That's submission. But when it's becoming difficult, you are a headache to your leader. To your partner, your order. There's a problem with your lifestyle. You are not sanctified. In fact, very soon, you will be receiving from the book of life. So when you are sanctified, you can submit. And you know that when there is no submission, there is no unity. See the book of Acts 2, verse 1. This one we often quote. Acts 2. Read with me there. In verse 1. Acts 2. Read verse 1. We quote this one often. So let's go there again. Acts 2. Read with me there in verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Nobody was saying, Peter, this is not reasonable.
We've been staying here.
What are we doing now?
He's not saying come. I think we should talk to Peter. I'm thinking that we are staying too long here.
And I was, I'm thinking the same way too.
We call the person and see him together. There was no pressure group right there. They were all with one accord. Submission brought their unity. They supported their leader. And what he said they were doing. Christ said tarry, they were tarrying. Peter also was tarrying. They were all tarrying, they were all together. See, down there, the crowd had left. They were still there. They were waiting. I pray that kind of spirit God will give us to you, Jesus. I told some time ago that if we will unite, see these fingers now. Each of the finger must bend. Am I right? If every finger is standing, can that be unity? If the small finger is standing, then it will be separated from the rest of the finger. If the ring finger is standing, then it will be separated. If the middle finger is standing, the index finger is standing, they will be separated. The thumb is standing. I said, look, I'm not your class. See, even all of you look at it now. Am I a witness here? I'm not in your category. And the third one is I'm longer. All of you, because I'm bend, but I won't bend. That cannot be unity. But in our bending, there is unity. If your opinion, you hold on to it. Our opinion, you hold on to it. Won't have unity. So submission of sanctification comes if you make us bend. And the eye in you becomes crushed into sin, crucified. If the eye now is now bent, what happens now? It comes to you. Then you are crucified with Christ. That's what means by submission. And when that submission comes, you have unity in the soul. And again, number three, there's sweetness. When you're sanctified, you are sweet. When you travel, we miss you. When you are around, you are happy. You find it easy to forgive people. They are people you are praying to. You say, who is not their prayers? You are forgiving them. Even the one that is going to come out and guys, you are praying for him. You are forgiving him. You are sweet. You are not piling up on your offenses. Sanctification will do all of these. Once you are sanctified, look, you'll be ready for heaven. All this kind of things, we are warming the sun and warming the sun and we are not moving. That will be gone. Sanctification on the pulpit, in the pew, and everywhere. We won't have to be policing you around to do the right thing. The fear of God will increase in the inside of you. Number seven, that is selflessness. Selfishness for the unsanctified, selflessness for the sanctified. You won't be selfish. The God of the prayer on earth is selfishness. Why is that? He talks to you that way because he's selfish. He wants to pull you down and say, look, I'm big, I'm higher than you. Because that's my authority here. Selfishness. But when you are sanctified, selfishness goes away. You are selfless. In fact, you prefer that he has it and I don't have it. I pray it will become my own tongue. And when it comes to him, first of all, you know that, you know that. Two sisters will be looking for two of the womb and they are praying. Then they are friendly. They are praying together. And God may not answer your prayer the same day. This one now becomes pregnant. And it says as his sister, in that time, the prayer will stop. Either of them, God has handled your own now. Let's turn to prayer. What God has done, he will keep it until fruition. And pray for me also that my own will come. Since the day he tells her that, sister, this is how, what has happened now. Let's praise God, though. If you say praise God, he will jubilate with that. It's not his prayer. Next week is not coming. All her body is detaining her. The week after, her husband travels. She won't be able to come. One way or the other, that's how that prayer will stop. She won't continue any longer. What is happening? Lack of sanctification. Selflessness will come when you are sanctified. You will be happy for him that he has it. And that my own is coming as well. That some of the things that we are even finding absent in our believers. Some believers, they won't have it. I wasn't born again when I started university. And I was I had a friend there now, he's a lecturer, and I said professor in Futa. And he was teaching, he was a great teacher, he was teaching in the secondary school. And my good friend, my very good friend. And about three of us were close that time. I wasn't born again. And by the time he was the first one that received letter of admission, that time they were still posting letter of admission, not like today. And they will post and you get and say you have been admitted. Then it was in the letter of admission, letter of Benin. My mom had not come, I still not of Lagos. And when his own came, I wasn't born again. That his own came, he came to meet me this morning, one Saturday morning, I said, see, they sent the letter, it's now, it's done. I was happy.
It's like something is telling that, look, since I've come to join your friend, your one is also coming close. And that was my attitude, that it's already getting to my neighbor, yes, it's me, it's getting close to me. I took that from him. I took it to my friends who I said the woman, I went to show them and say, see, my friend had been admitted. And some months later also, the same session, my own friend, we all entered the university together. I want to say I was sanctified. I want to say I was godly. I want to say I was born again. I was only a moralist in some sense. But then, some of these things that we are even looking for in Israel, we don't find. It's now from unbelievers. When you are selfish, Jesus, and then you are saved, you Calvary, then you be selfless, you will love others, like yourself. What you wish for yourself, that's what will be happening unto them. I say it's coming your way. Then, lastly, you want to serve God. When you love God, what was his work failing? Service. That is service. He loves service. You want to serve God. And what want to work him? He wants to watch his work failing. You want to make sure that something happens that will really, really do God's work. And that God will be happy with you. You want to make him happy all the time. You are looking for everything to do. That God will be happy with you. See what God is saying. Malachi 3. You see there in verse 5. Malachi 3. Verse 5. Malachi 3. Verse 5. Malachi 3. Verse 5. I shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. God will refine you. He will purify you. I shall purify the sons of Levi. Who are the sons of Levi here? These are the workers. Purify the sons of Levi. And purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer. When I sanctify, you are ready for service. The light has many verses. Some to honor, some to dishonor. If any man purge himself from all this, he be a vessel unto honor. Sanctify me for the master's use. Now he says that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. Then shall the offering of Judah and Jerusalem be pleasant unto the Lord as in days of old and as in former years. That's what will happen. Then your offering is acceptable. Can I offer acceptable service? If I have received service, you without an invitation, with ego, with wrong motive, I will show them that, look, I've arrived. And that's your motive. You are praising yourself right there. You make an effort for yourself right there. And look, this one, I don't know, I may not be passing anywhere, but even like they're making me all this year, they are there, I will show them. It's just your attitude. Your service is not acceptable even unto God. So it's not saying that the offering of Jerusalem and the Yemen and Judah shall be acceptable unto God. I say your offering is acceptable. So that will happen when you are sanctified. Then how do you become sanctified? What am I saying now? The process of sanctification. The process. Leviticus 20. Verse 7 to 3. Leviticus 20. Read with me. Verse 7. Leviticus 20. Verse 7. Sanctify yourselves, therefore, and be ye holy. From the Lord your God. In our own dispensation, two sides and sanctification. Number one, you sanctify yourself. Number two, God sanctify you. What do you mean by sanctify yourself? Sanctify yourself means consecrate yourself. Bring yourself to the altar. I was telling my brother some minutes ago, before I started the message, came to ask me something. He was telling me something, he was with me. And I told him that consecration means, when you go to, like, you go to the farm and you mash a thorn and it pierces your leg and breaks your side. It's very, very painful. And by the time you stay overnight, it's like, if you enjoy your sleep, something spoils in your body. Then you look for someone. Maybe you buy a razor yourself and you give him. Please help me remove this thorn. You are the one looking for him. Am I right? You are the one calling him. And you get there. You put your leg somewhere, maybe you have to buy something, and it gives you something. It's cutting your flesh, you are enjoying it. You are there allowing him. You are like thus a patient on the slab, on the theater. and the doctor can afford to do whatever he likes. And it's not struggling with the doctor. In fact, that's even the better illustration. And they now kind of, they said anesthesia. Now they talk about local or total anesthesia. And now they give some drug or something into your body, and off you don't even know where you are again. They can call the appendicitis, can call the IV, can do something about the INA. If it's that session, they can take away the side. You won't know. You are free before you are awake. Means you are believe before you wake up. That's just like consecration. You bring yourself on the altar and say, God, do with me whatever. That's sanctifying yourself. That's your own part. Then, when it's that you are true, you are sincere, and you are ready there on the slab, then it comes round. Then he cut what needs to be cut, he removes what needs to be removed, he plants what needs to be planted, the clean heart, he puts in the inside of you. Sanctify yourself. Sanctify yourself means that you must give deliberate efforts to be holy. You are in the place, you are empty in the vehicle. And there are guests around that can defy you. You sit down in a short place where that will not happen. You enjoy your gates on what I make and police your heart. You are keeping yourself, that's sanctifying yourself. When God says that you are doing that, that's consecration, then you now come near. But if you are not doing that, you are your own part, you are not doing it. And you are waiting for me to do his own part, it will never happen that way. So if you sanctify yourself, then you'll be holy. And that is the beginning of the process. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. See what it's now saying in the New Testament. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. And in verse 1, 2 Corinthians chapter 7. Be with me in verse 1, 2 Corinthians chapter 7. I'm showing you something quickly in verse 1. The process of sanctification. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. Quickly in verse 1. Having therefore these promises. What is the promise? We believe that we have our enemies and serve without fear in holiness and righteousness for the Lord of our life. That's the promise. That we will cleanse you, we purge you, we wash you, and I will be faithful to you. Shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let's cleanse ourselves as a cleansing of yourself from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. That's the creation. You cleanse yourself, forgive me, purge me, purify me, take away all these things. You hate all of those things. And now say, do it in me. And you are there, or he does it. If the man is removing your tongue from your head and has not finished removing, and they are just for that, and you stand up, would that be a respite? Will you be free? But if you pray, and you pray until something happens, and God will ask you, this one is so ready to go until I do something, I better do something right now. That's what God wants to do. And that is what God is asking for. You come to the altar, you lay yourself, you pray, you plead, and by the time God finishes, and I'm sure God will do for some people here today. And when God does it for you, you keep finding it, you keep keeping it. When Abraham put those sacrifices on the altar, and God talks to God and he drove them away. You keep your altar and you don't want anything like that song. It was rebellious. Just like I told you before. That you now bring that heart and you pray and you bring that heart unto God and say, this heart is rebellious. This heart is evil. This heart is dirty. This heart is unclean. It's lustful. It's malicious. It doesn't forgive. It hates. And everything, say everything. I don't say anything good. It is not committing sin in the outward. But it's pushing me. The appetite is wrong. It's dirty. It's unholy. And therefore, I don't want it any longer. And God here and now, do something. I believe that because of me, you die on the cross. And that outside the gate, behind the gate, beside the army, without the gate. Therefore, I'm calling you there right now. I'm carrying my repose. I'm carrying the cross. I want to die there. Let him die out in me. Remove it. And you plead with him. You talk. And there's a transaction. You don't keep quiet. And you talk and talk. You talk your way through. And believe that actually the provision had been made. If Paul was sanctified, you can be sanctified. If Paul was sanctified, you can be sanctified. So as they did, they were terrible. They were fiery. But and at the point of sanctification, they were meek, they were easy, they were simple, they were sweet, and they could live with it. It's okay with them. No envy, no jealousy any longer, and it can happen again. Because he said that day is come, and that over will open up a fountain on the house of Jerusalem, for the house of Israel, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and a fountain shall be opened, and for shame and for uncleanness. That shame is still in you, it cannot be that fountain. Now, next, you see, because that spotting is there, you are not making use of it. That issue is now there to now. And the blood of Christ will perfect you, purge you, and make you holy. Those are they that are pure in heart. So you can see God. Want to see God? All over the gospel. It can happen here. Bring your rebellious son unto God. Go without the city. This is the end of the matter. Making heaven reside here. If we ever see God, nothing that defiles can enter through the gate of prayer. If we ever see God, this is where the matter is. If we make heaven, if all are a worker and a worker, if you need anything, this is where the matter resides. If your service is acceptable, this is where the matter resides. All this one that you are struggling with your own power, is not, it cannot work. Struggling will end. You will resign. You will go into your rest. There is many therefore a rest for the people of God. Then you will rest from your struggle. Rest from your struggle. Serenity. Peace. Stillness. Within. Noise gone. Crisis gone. Conflict gone. Ferocity gone. Then you'll be pure. And a peace within you. Peace of God. You'll be covered. Insulated in your heart against sin. God will purge you, he will perfect you, and Lord will sanctify you wholly. And will purge you, circumcise your heart, and the heart of your children, of your offspring. The time is come. He will sit as a refiner and a preparer of silver. Tend to refine you. Refine me, refine me. Refine me, O God. Refine me, O God. Refine me, O God. If you pray little, you will not have the experience. If you are quiet, nothing will happen. If you are in a hurry, you will not get the experience. Pray until you are sure something can happen. You know, on the altar. Say, is it now or never?
More holiness, Lord, give me. If you will call upon the name of the Lord is healing. It's in the picture, it's in the portrait, or it's in the process. It has been demystified to us, explained in a clear language and in a common manner, that God Almighty will make this experience real. We make it real. If it is not possible, the Lord will not command it. It has been commanded, and you can see that in this, even in the midst of that adulterous generation, that by the grace of God, we can see it in the life of some of our leaders. That God Almighty will make it possible for you. It's possible for our leader, it's possible for us. That God Almighty will work it out. Crucify self. Crucify self. Is it possible to have the submissiveness? Is it possible to have the simplicity? Is it possible to have the sweetness? Is it possible that we do away with self? Crucify self so that we can allow the experience to come to see. That God, the process. See the process. Self must be dealt with. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Brethren, do you know that all letters, activity, commitment to the church, to self, to whatever you may say we are doing in the church. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. You don't even get it not for your own personal benefit alone on this earth, but for your soul to gain eternity. Brethren, you know we are not living for self. For living, for Savior, for others, and for the first, that God Almighty will crucify self in us. It is possible. It was possible for Paul and Silas. It was possible for the saints of old. Contemporary believers are living it out. Our Father and the Lord has showed us this afternoon some of these attributes will find difficult to exhibit. Unbelievers outside there who never do out of ignorance is manifesting in them. Why that we that have the knowledge? Yeah, that we that know the benefit, they find it difficult to live it out. The difference is grace. Brethren, you are for the grace. It's not self, it's not self, it's not personal effort. If you struggle, you may not have it. Set all that all thy iniquities, all thy iniquities, within and without, it is possible. Ask the Savior, is willing to aid you. He's willing to sanctify us. Say, sanctify them to thy truth, for thy word is true. The word that you have been let out to us. From the throne of grace, that let that word cleanse you, cleanse me from all filthiness of the flesh. Within, all those struggling, secret love are taking over from your sincere love. How to ask the Savior for this secret love, lost in the heart, not visible to man, but so to stand up before Almighty, that God Almighty will do the second work of grace. So we start with us anew. Believer that had this experience before, you need not to shut up your mouth. You can grow in sanctification. You can never exhaust the depth of sanctification. No matter the length of time for how long you've gotten it, you can grow in it. As far as you have seen on this surface of death, you can't exhaust the depth of sanctification. More holiness, Lord, give me more righteous within. More gratitude, Lord, give me. Lord, it is possible. Do it for me. You did it for saints of old, you can do it again. Why do we listen to finding messages and believe? They find it easy. It's not that the temptation has been thrown away in the world. There are temptations, so you need a greater power within you. If you are not the carrier of that grace, it will be difficult to stand in this 24th century. Iniquity shall abound. Knowledge shall increase. The more knowledge increase, the more difficult it is to live the righteous life. So you can get what it takes to live it. And that's the place of prayer. The grace is what makes a difference. People are standing and those who are falling. People are standing constantly and continuously, and those who are rising and falling, the difference is grace. So let's prepare in the place of prayer. God help me. I want to be like thee. More holiness. More holiness. More holiness. The only desire of my heart is to be like Jesus. Is that same thing with you? To be like Jesus. Only strong desire of my heart is to be like Jesus. To be like him in secret. To be like him in open. To be like you when I travel to village. To be like you when I'm in the town. To be like you when I'm in the city. That is the only thing that can secure us heaven. Every other thing will perish in this world. Certificate is good, but it's only meant to cater for us in this world. Why don't you consider where the soul will rest at last? Brethren, pray, pray, pray. Secure your teaching in the place of prayer. That's the essence of a program like this. What do you need? What do you have after activity? And brethren, we still go home after a program like this. Brethren, the difference is this. The temptation in the world we understand. So God will be letting some people to come, can help us. If you secure the grace in the place of prayer. That God help me. Lord help me to follow your banner. So serve you wherever I go. Remember service. This sanctification will render service. This sanctification will render all your service. The only service of the Master. Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart. Lord, I want to be more holy in my heart. In my heart. In my heart. Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart. Lord, give me the grace. Jesus came, he was tempted, he overcame. Because he had the greater power within him. Brethren, the greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Just pray, it is possible. God make me holy. God make me holy. God make me holy. God make me holy. Secure the purity of us in the place of prayer. Secure purity of us in the place of prayer. More about Jesus will I know. Pray and be satisfied. And when you are sure that God has satisfied your thirst to be like him, you can embark on grace any moment from now. You'll be coming back by 3:40.